Calorama, a Recorded Books hybrid imprint, presents Around the World in More Than 80 Days, Discovering What Makes America Great and Why We Must Fight to Save It, by Larry Alex Taunton, read by John Pruden. Perhaps there has been, at some point in history, some great power whose elevation was exempt from the violent exploitation of other human bodies. If there has been, I have yet to discover it. But this banality of violence can never excuse America, because America makes no claim to the banal. America believes itself exceptional, the greatest and noblest nation ever to exist. I propose to take our countrymen's claims of American exceptionalism seriously, which is to say, I propose subjecting our country to an exceptional moral standard. Ta-Nehisi Coates, in his New York Times bestseller, Between the World and Me. In 32 years of living in this country, the United States has never once failed me. Becoming an American citizen was the greatest privilege of my life. Your book reads like an American horror story because you have damned to hell the noblest and most endearing trait of those who come to this country and who love it, the dream. You declare, this is the foundation of the dream. Its adherents must not just believe in it, but believe that it is just, believe that their possession of the dream is the natural result of grit, honor, and good works. Well, it is. And we, the dreamers and achievers who continue to make this country the exceptional wonder that it is, will never capitulate to your renunciation. The world we desired has been won. It exists. It is real. It is possible. It is ours. And it should be yours and your sons. Jason D. Hill, professor of philosophy at DePaul University, who immigrated to the United States from Jamaica at age 20, in An Open Letter to Ta-Nehisi Coates, The Dream is Real, Commentary Magazine. Prologue. America on Trial. How can you stand for the national anthem of a nation that preaches and propagates freedom and justice for all that's so unjust to the people living there? Former NFL quarterback Colin Kaepernick. Colin Kaepernick was born in 1987 in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. He is the biological child of a single white mother, Heidi Russo, whose partner, an African-American, fled the relationship when he learned she was pregnant. Russo, then 19, decided to allow Rick and Teresa Kaepernick, a white couple, to adopt the newborn boy. In their care, young Colin would be given a life and opportunities that almost certainly would have eluded him otherwise. Raised in a Christian family, Colin was baptized as a Methodist and confirmed as a Lutheran. Quiet and good-natured, it soon became clear the boy was a talented athlete, too. In high school, he excelled in baseball, basketball, and football, and eventually received numerous scholarship offers to play collegiate baseball. But Kaepernick had big dreams of playing football. "I hope I go to a good college in football," he wrote in the fourth grade, "then go to the pros and play on the Niners or the Packers, even if they aren't good in 7 years." America being what it is, with his hard work and talent, his dream came true. In 2007, Kaepernick accepted the football scholarship and free education offered him by the University of Nevada. He took his Christian faith seriously, attending a Baptist church during this time and adding his now famous tattoos illustrating verses from the Bible and a Christian cross. With faith in his God, Kaepernick won the starting job as quarterback for the Wolfpack, and in 2010, he led them to a 13-1 record and their first top 25 ranking in 62 years. True to his dream, Kaepernick was selected by the San Francisco 49ers in the second round of the 2011 NFL Draft. After a rookie year where he was the backup to quarterback Alex Smith, Kaepernick earned the starting job and led the 49ers to Super Bowl 47. Although they lost to the Baltimore Ravens 34-31, Kaepernick played well, The following year, he steered the 49ers back to the playoffs and an NFC Championship game berth where they lost to the Seattle Seahawks. During the offseason, Kaepernick signed a 6-year contract extension worth up to $126 million. Life was good. Then came injuries, bad play, and a benching. In 2015, Kaepernick was replaced by Blaine Gabbert. As clear a sign as any, the San Francisco 49ers no longer believed in his ability to lead the team to a championship. Still, were he to never complete another pass, Colin Kaepernick succeeded wildly in the only country on earth where one could become a millionaire playing the game he loved. He was young, rich, and a world of possibilities remained open to him. It is here that Kaepernick's story takes a dark turn. It is not uncommon for adopted children to struggle with identity, and Kaepernick often struggled with his. The impression one gets of the young Colin Kaepernick is that of a man with a genuine social conscience, but whose Christian faith, while replete with platitudes, tattoos, and sincerity, was lacking in theological substance. Ideological deserts are fertile ground for propagandists, and in the summer of 2016, the likable kid who wrote in elementary school enthusiastically of his American dream fell under the influence of radical social justice warrior, SJW, Amir Hassan Loggins, a Muslim convert and hip-hop icon come Berkeley professor. With Loggins' encouragement, Kaepernick audited Loggins' course on popular culture at Berkeley. Loggins characterizes Kaepernick as a hard-working, earnest student who was eager to learn. What exactly was Kaepernick learning under this new mentor? In sum, Loggins, who styles himself as an intellectual and modern-day Malcolm X, teaches, among other things, Islam is a religion of black liberation, capitalism is a system of oppression, and American history as one act of violence and exploitation after another. According to the New York Times, Loggins introduced the NFL quarterback to Nessa Diab, an olive-skinned beauty of Egyptian parentage who has made her name as a Muslim-American activist and Bay Area shock jock. Diab is California-born, but spent many of her childhood years in Saudi Arabia, where, she says, her sense of social justice grew. Outspoken in her support for Black Lives Matter and in her respect for such champions of justice as Fidel Castro, her views mirror those of Loggins. She and Kaepernick soon began a romantic relationship, and under the influence of Loggins' teaching and her sweet nothings, the radicalization of Colin Kaepernick was well underway. It seems hardly coincidental that in Kaepernick's social media posts, there now appeared indications of a new identity. This Colin Kaepernick was an angry political activist. He tweeted of lynching, murder, and bodies in the streets of America. Unsurprisingly, he expressed his admiration for Fidel Castro and Malcolm X. The oppression of black people at the hands of white police officers was a theme. "We are under attack," he wrote. "It's as clear as day." Worse, he increasingly sounded like the black equivalent of a white supremacist, assuming the language of the violent revolutionary complete with the Black Panther Black Power salute. It is not hard to see the influence of his new handlers in all this. When Kaepernick decided to take a knee during the national anthem of a preseason game in 2016, he became the symbolic leader of the resistance, a kind of domestic anti-Americanism that deems this country the root of all evil. Perhaps due to the distraction, perhaps due to the accumulated injuries, Kaepernick was a shadow of his former self, and facing release from the 49ers, he opted for free agency. When no team picked him up, Kaepernick, the man who was an overcomer his whole life, who lived the American dream, became a victim, accusing the NFL of collusion. But America being what it is, the NFL settled out of court. Some estimates put the settlement as high as $80 million, and Kaepernick signed a lucrative endorsement deal with Nike. Soon, they were marketing his image on billboards and television as something like an American Che Guevara to those foolish enough to think either is worthy of emulation. Let's recap. Colin Kaepernick was born in a country where adoption is not only possible, but where the prevailing moral attitudes made his adoption likely. He loved sports, and because his talents were valued, he enjoyed a free university education and a highly profitable career. When that career failed, he blamed others, and the American legal system rewarded him handsomely, as if a deep and genuine wrong was done to him, even though no wrong was ever legally established. And since this is a country where people are free to profit by any legal means whatsoever, he was even able to parlay his twin roles of victim and SJW into a major corporate sponsorship worth millions. By any measure, Colin Kaepernick has flourished and profited under an American sky. What a country, eh? Colin Kaepernick's story is instructive for my purpose in this book. He is one of the faces of a discontented demographic who would put America on trial. Indeed, with all the statues being toppled these days, one wonders if the next one to fall might not be that of Lady Liberty. A lynch mob gathers at her feet to punish her for her sins, past and present, real and imagined. But this mob is not, as one might suppose, led by the likes of Vladimir Putin or Xi Jinping. Nor is it led by ISIS or Al-Qaeda. Rather, this mob consists of homegrown radicals like Colin Kaepernick, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, and Richard Spencer, and groups with names like Black Lives Matter, Antifa, or those who fall under the broad banner of the alt-right. Fringe elements all, these groups see themselves as social justice personified, but are in fact the embodiment of anarchy, violence, and the politics of hateful reaction. Yes, Michael Moore-style America bashing is in vogue. Whether it is Ashley Judd shouting hate on the Washington Mall, George Soros-funded protests, Barack Obama apologizing for American arrogance, or Rose McGowan tweeting, "I am a conscientious objector to the USA, its policies, lies, corruption, nationalism, racism, and deep misogyny." These are the one side of a battle raging for the heart and soul of America. President Donald Trump's White House has become the flashpoint in a winner-takes-all contest featuring two very different visions for America. One group sees America's wealth, power, and influence as an accident of history. For them, the idea of American exceptionalism is not only dead, it is offensive. These people never tire of lecturing us about how out of step America is with the rest of the world and how she needs to get with it. America, they say, is bad for the world. Moreover, where America is exceptional, a deep suspicion of socialism and environmentalism, strongly Christian in a post-Christian world, and alone patriotic among Western nations swept up in a globalist dream, is where America is at her worst and must change. Others want to preserve America's uniqueness, her exceptionalism that is anchored in a Judeo-Christian heritage that has given rise to her laws, art, literature, culture, and place in the world as a refuge from just the types of governments the left idealizes. Proponents of this vision would readily acknowledge that America's global influence has at times been evil, but this is, they would argue, the result of an agenda that has nothing whatsoever to do with the principles upon which America was founded. On the contrary, that agenda, championed by the left and epitomized by America's bullying of third world countries to adopt permissive abortion and LGBTQ policies, is at odds with those principles. The war between these competing visions is played out every day in local and national government, in our courts of law, in schools and universities, in media, and even in families. Listening to this cultural debate, it is not only inescapable, but it is also tearing our country apart. It occurred to me the vision advocated by those who would burn America to the ground, Ferguson, Missouri style, presupposes there are better places in the world to live. Are there? Were Colin Kaepernick or Alec Baldwin, as he once promised, to move to another country, where would he go? If they think there are better options, they have forgotten, if they ever knew it in the first place, what the rest of the world is like. Earlier, I included a quotation from Ta-Nehisi Coates' Between the World and Me, encapsulating his indictment of America. For the uninitiated, Coates is an atheist SJW agitator author who is the intellectual version of Colin Kaepernick. While Coates is in many ways my ideological opposite, as a writer, I nonetheless often admire his writing for its beauty and honesty. Unfortunately, it is too often laden with the author's insistence that he, and all people of color, are victims. He ends the aforementioned quotation with this: "I propose to take our countrymen's claims of American exceptionalism seriously, which is to say, I propose subjecting our country to an exceptional moral standard." Well, I propose to take the left's claims of America as an evil exploiter oppressor very seriously, which is to say, I propose subjecting other countries to an exceptional moral standard, too. It seems a little perspective might be in order here. To that end, in this book, I hope to provide that missing perspective, but not from the comfort of the armchair. No. I will take you around the world to 26 countries in all on a great expedition to see if the American left and their media allies are right. Along the way, we will answer several pressing questions. Is America's prosperity merely an accident of history, the Islamic narrative, and a result of the exploitation of the weak, the left's narrative? Or are some cultures superior to others by virtue of their religion and political philosophy? Do reasonable people around the world hate America, or are they unsettled by our current identity crisis? Is Europe's open borders policy bringing cultural enrichment we should model, or is it laying the foundation for the gradual overthrow of Western culture as we know it? Is America exceptional in ways that matter, and should she remain so? Or should America, the last holdout in the West against globalism, militant secularism, and climate change panic, tap out and become a socialist democracy like those of Europe? An expedition like this promises to reveal a great many things, not the least of which is all we risk losing and what we risk becoming if we join a Western world hell-bent on suicide. At the end of our journey, we will have discovered one of two things: the left is right, and America really isn't so great after all, or we will see she remains, as Abraham Lincoln put it, the last best hope of Earth. So, get your passport, a sturdy backpack, and activate your Sky Miles account. Oh, and some handy wipes. You're going to need lots of handy wipes. The world is a very dirty place. Chapter 1. The Criteria. What defines a great country? He who would defend all defends nothing, because defense lines cover more ground than available troops can defend. Little minds want to defend everything. Sensible men concentrate on the essentials. Frederick the Great. In 1831, French political philosopher Alexis de Tocqueville came to America. What started as a review of American prisons became a travelogue of a man determined to search out the source of America's strength. He crisscrossed the country, scribbling notes of his observations as he went. The result was his classic and remarkably still relevant Democracy in America. Tocqueville hoped his book would give the people of his native France perspective for the turbulent times in which they lived. If subsequent French history is any indication, they didn't read it. Now, roughly two centuries later, I, along with my 22-year-old son Zachary, set out to do what Tocqueville did, but in reverse. That is, rather than traveling across America to see how it compared with Europe and France in particular, we were instead planning to circumnavigate the Earth to see how America really stacks up against those countries that would serve as a model for the America some wish to create. Such an expedition is no easy undertaking. Fortunately, international travel today is easy, safe, and efficient. Even so, extensive planning is required for a trip like this. The first order of business was to make sure our passports would not expire during our odyssey. Most countries will not allow entry to travelers unless their passports are valid for a minimum of 6 months after their declared exit dates. Which countries would require visas? This meant a bit of research. Then we needed to plan a tentative route. I say tentative because while we knew what countries must be included in such a survey, we wanted to maintain a degree of flexibility. What if someone got sick or the political situation required us to leave in a hurry? Rigid travel plans are a recipe for a miserable experience. Besides, we knew some countries would prove more interesting than others, so we wanted to be free to linger or move on. Booking flights for an around-the-world trip is easier than you might think. Most airlines offer a little-known round-the-world RTW ticket. While the rules vary from one carrier to another, they generally work like this. You can create your own itinerary, but you must remain within that airline's network. If none of their carriers fly, say, to Singapore, you'll have to skip it or pay for it separately. The ticket allows for continuous eastbound or westbound travel. The choice is yours. But once you start, you have to keep going the direction you've chosen. There's no going back, unless you pay for the off-course trips. We had to do this several times. You are allowed to cross the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans only once. There is typically a limit on mileage and/or stops. The ticket is good for 1 year. Having purchased tickets, all that remained was to pack. Author Susan Heller wrote, "When preparing to travel, lay out all your clothes and all your money. Then take half the clothes and twice the money." That is good advice. People, Americans most of all, tend to overpack. This was particularly tempting for us simply because we would be gone so long, would be settling down nowhere, and would travel from baking countries on or near the equator to countries stretching to the polar extremities. One day might find us in shorts and t-shirts, sweating in tropical heat. The next, we might be bundled down trying to stay warm. This made packing complicated. Taking Heller's advice, we made sure we had sufficient financing. You can always buy another pair of socks or shoes, but if you don't have the money, you are in trouble. Beyond the obvious reasons for this, any trip including a third world country is going to involve informal expenses. By this, of course, I mean bribes. They aren't always called that. They might be called gratuities, service fees, Nian Cha, Thailand, tea money, Hermat, Azerbaijan, respect, Dash, Nigeria, gift, Grasse, France, Greece, Cafezino, Brazil, a little coffee, or any of a number of other things. But make no mistake about it, they are bribes, and your trip will go much smoother if you are prepared to pay them. I am not advising you to pay all bribes or any sum that might be demanded. Like almost everything in the third world, bribes are negotiable, and there are times when I do not pay them. But whenever it involves my safety or that of the people with me, I pay. But not until the thing I am paying for is done. Thus armed, we would take one piece of checked baggage and one carry-on each. On Sunday, August 27th, 2017, I kissed my wife Lori goodbye, gave my daughter Sasha a hug, and Zachary and I headed to the airport. We decided to circumnavigate the globe via the westbound route. So, beginning in Birmingham, Alabama, we flew to Los Angeles, our launching point for Asia-Oceania. On long-haul flights, I come prepared. I immediately change into loose-fitting clothes, put on socks or slippers, put on my noise-canceling headphones, and settle in with a book or a movie before trying, usually without success, to sleep. Now that we are somewhere over the Pacific Ocean, it seems like a perfect time to establish some criteria for what is, in effect, an expedition to find the world's greatest country. In such a search, how will we define greatness? A simple internet search of best state or greatest country will yield very different results. Those results are based on the criteria used by those answering the question. What was important to them? Access to affordable health care, the country's carbon footprint, social mobility. My criteria will differ substantially from most of the lists I have consulted. That is because these rankings, which are all over the internet, usually rely heavily on data and have a hidden agenda. Take, for example, this recent list. It was produced by Condé Nast Traveler and is typical of the genre. Here is their ranking of countries. 1. Norway. 2. Austria, Switzerland, tie. 3. Due to the tie for number 2, there is no number 3. 4. Germany. 5. Denmark, Singapore, tie. 6. No number 6. 7. The Netherlands. 8. Ireland. 9. Iceland. 10. Canada, the United States, tie. People seeing these rankings often accept them as authoritative without looking at the criteria those compiling them employed and wonder why the United States scored so low. Let's drill down a bit in this. The list is based on the United Nations Development Program's Annual Human Development Index. Reading the report, I soon discover why Condé Nast, a media behemoth that owns Vanity Fair, GQ, Allure, and Vogue, likes it. It is precisely the sort of data and social agenda-laden report the left employs to declare life's winners and losers. A simple word search of the document yields the results. Gay, 34 times. Transgender, 30 times. Bisexual, 29 times. Lesbian, 27 times. LGBTI, 8 times. I then looked at every instance where these words were used in the report. Each time, they were used favorably or in defense of these lifestyles. So concerned was the United Nations that this human right be legalized and promoted in every country, the report said. Awareness campaigns need to be launched in households. But what about Christians? Christians are the world's largest religious group, numbering 2.2 billion people. According to Spectator, UK, they are also the most persecuted, dying for their faith at a startling rate of 100,000 per year. That translates to 11 per hour. So, given these facts, how many times were Christians mentioned in the UN report? Christians, 0 times. What about the Christian religion? Christianity, 0 times. What about the persecution of Christians? Persecution was mentioned 3 times, but not once in this context. Religion was mentioned 17 times, but 6 of those were in a single footnote. Religions were lumped together and often unfavorably. Yet when it came to LGBTI issues, I have no idea what the I refers to. Those generating the report made a great distinction between an apparent multitude of sexual identities and preferences. What percentage of the world's population are the T's and I's? More than, say, Hindus and Buddhists, who also netted 0 mentions in this study? What this tells us, of course, is that religion is unimportant to those generating this report, and for that reason, they weren't qualified to produce such a study in the first place. Perhaps they are unaware of it, but religion is very important to the vast majority of the world's population. Yet the gurus over at the UN, in a weighty study that essentially ranks the quality of life in 185 countries, didn't think it merited a substantive discussion. LGBTI activism, however, was of great importance to them, and that is what the mentioned countries all have in common. In each of them, LGBTI people are practically a protected species. The UN might have saved themselves some time and money by just consulting TripAdvisor. As I have said, a given ranking will be determined by the criteria used, and that criteria will be determined by what is important to those doing the survey. I find little in rankings of this kind reflecting my values and those of many people I know, be they American or otherwise. And that is because these studies generally place a premium on things that, although important to those committed to a progressive agenda, are of little importance to most people. Globally, most people aren't losing sleep over the polar ice cap and paid paternity leave. They are, however, preoccupied with concerns of safety, provision for themselves and/or their families, and the ability to live their lives freely. My criteria have such people in mind. I am reacting against the strictly statistical approach to determining national greatness. The left loves data because it can be manipulated to justify dubious agendas. Twain was right when he said, there are lies, damned lies, and statistics. Besides, surely a nation is more than the sum of its economic, demographic, and governmental parts. The quality of life, of a single life, cannot be reduced to a number. Advocates of abortion and euthanasia employ that kind of thinking with devastating effect. In using statistics on income, intelligence, and education, they have judged the lives of millions to be unworthy of living. Planned Parenthood has made an industry out of it. Iceland celebrates it. Yes, I am convinced the devil is a bureaucrat and a statistician. That is not to say, however, data is irrelevant. It isn't. The cost of living, life expectancy, access to clean water, murder rates, number of regime changes, and so forth offer insight into a culture, but they cannot tell you the quality of it. And this brings me to my criteria. For a country to be considered great on our list, certain characteristics must be present. Freedoms, political, economic, and religious, are non-negotiable. A nation's history is also a factor. Why? Because it is the best predictor of the future. Historically, France has a penchant for strikes, uprisings, and revolutions. Russia and China have little regard for personal liberties and a habit of genocide. We know Islamic states create cookie-cutter societies and oppress non-Muslims. Switzerland has demonstrated a commitment to pragmatic peace and commerce. Those histories matter. How is a country trending? Toward greater freedom, increased regulation, or tyranny? Social mobility is a key component. Can people through hard work and talent flourish, or do social, economic, and governmental conditions actively conspire against it? What is life like for ordinary people? If it isn't good, what chance do they have of improving it? And what are the things most valued by that society? What I say about other nations' characteristics, for example, cuisine, climate, landscape, is merely reflective of my preference and is not, therefore, a determining factor in my assessment of a given country. I am, after all, offering you my opinion of these countries. That said, statistics and opinions aside, there is, I believe, an absolute standard. The preamble to the U.S. Constitution is a pithy summary of what we are looking for in the governments of the countries we are visiting on this trip. We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. Some will say this is unfair because it is an American standard, but the values expressed in the preamble are not exclusively American. On the contrary, the framers of the Constitution were appealing to what they understood to be an absolute universal standard of human rights. To quote the late Forrest MacDonald, an American constitutional historian of some eminence and a professor of mine, the Declaration of Independence refers to God-given rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The preamble of the Constitution introduces a document whose stated purpose is to secure the rights of life and liberty. Please bear in mind our country reviews are necessarily brief and therefore by no means comprehensive. I quoted Frederick the Great at the beginning of this chapter for a reason. A danger for any author is to write with his critics in mind. If he does, a good 200-page book that defends the essentials and informs the interested risks becoming a dull, ponderous 500-page tome as the author attempts to anticipate every objection to his thesis. This book was not written for critics. I naively attempted to do that with my previous book, The Faith of Christopher Hitchens, The Restless Soul of the World's Most Notorious Atheist. Knowing they would be looking for me to claim Hitchens made a deathbed conversion, I wrote an entire chapter outlining why I was making no such claims. I was emphatic on the point. That book, named the Arts and Culture Book of the Year 2016 by the Gospel Coalition and glowingly reviewed by Publishers Weekly, The Wall Street Journal, Christianity Today, The Times of London, and even Chris Matthews of MSNBC's Hardball, was nonetheless savagely attacked by the atheist mafia who accused me of making the deathbed conversion claim anyway. No, I won't do that here. Rather, it is my hope that this little book will educate and entertain the intelligent layman who share my deep concern for where America is headed and want to do something about it. My perspective is that of an American, but that's okay because my target audience is American too, though I would be delighted if my book became a bestseller in, say, China. Finally, it is important to understand that there is a big difference between visiting a country on vacation and living there as most of the population lives. This is what I call the traveler's fallacy. Vacationing in a Jamaican resort should not be confused with life for the average Jamaican. Likewise, many of the world's great cities are lovely places to live if you can afford to live in the high-priced city centers, but almost no one can afford it. Indeed, any country can seem tolerable if you are a one percenter. Louis XIV, surrounded as he was with mistresses and courtiers to satiate his every desire, seems to have been happy enough. So were Genghis Khan, Chairman Mao, and Saddam Hussein. But that is in no way an indication of life in those countries. While we are citizens of none of the countries in our survey but the United States, we weren't typical tourists either. We hope to give you a glimpse of the reality of life in the countries we visited. Before we begin our expedition, let me show you a different statistical ranking, one that is, I think, much more telling than what activist academics at the UN are writing. It is a de facto ranking of the world's countries by ordinary people around the world. In a global poll conducted by Gallup, 14% of the surveyed global population said they would like to migrate permanently to another country. That's roughly 700 million people. Of that number, a whopping 21%, or 147 million people, would like to move to the United States of America. The next highest country was Germany, with 6%. Norway, number one on the UN's ranking, didn't even make the list. This raises some very interesting questions. Chief among them is this: why do these people want to come to America? What makes America, dare I say it, exceptional? To answer that question, we need to know a little about the rest of the world. To that end, Zachary and I will take you to 6 continents and 26 countries. Let the journey begin. Chapter 2. Singapore. OCD? Tired of democracy? This country is for you. Whoever governs Singapore must have iron in him, or give up. This is not a game of cards. This is your life and mine. Lee Kuan Yew, Singapore's founding father. Our plan was to visit 26 countries. In reality, the number of legitimate contenders for the title of the world's greatest country is rather small, with perhaps 10 countries in the running. So why, then, were we including more than double that number? We believed it necessary to give you the bigger picture of what the rest of the world is like, as well as to understand America's global influence. According to a report by Verisk Maplecroft, a socioeconomic and political analysis firm, 40% of the world's countries will experience political unrest in 2020. That translates to a mind-boggling 75 countries. We would be hitting about 5 on this list in our circumnavigation of the Earth. Circumnavigating the Earth has long captured the public imagination. Perhaps the most famous circumnavigator of them all is the fictitious English gentleman Phileas Fogg, who completed the journey with his faithful valet Passepartout in Jules Verne's classic 1873 novel Around the World in 80 Days. That story has been retold in one form or another in no less than 20 films starring the likes of Conrad Veidt, David Niven, Pierce Brosnan, and Steve Coogan. But long before Verne immortalized the idea of such an adventure, others actually accomplished the feat. The Portuguese explorer Ferdinand Magellan is credited with being the first to do it, but that isn't actually true. Magellan only semi-circumnavigated the Earth. He was killed by Filipino tribesmen on the island of Mactan in April 1521, being the unfortunate recipient of a bamboo spear to the face. However, after more than 3 years, what was left of his starving crew did finish the journey, reaching Spain in September of 1522. A fleet consisting of 5 ships and 270 men was reduced to 1 ship and 18 men. Circumnavigation became much easier with the opening of the Suez, 1869, and Panama, 1914, canals, allowing ships to avoid the treacherous route around South America's Cape Horn and Africa's Cape of Good Hope. With these advantages, Frenchman Francis Joyon and a crew of 8 sailed around the world in 40 days, 23 hours, and 30 minutes in 2017, setting a new record. Then came the invention of the airplane. The first to circumnavigate the Earth by air was the United States Army Air Service in 1924. With aviation still in its infancy, it took them a whopping 175 days. By 1949, the United States Air Force trimmed that time to an astonishing 94 hours and 1 minute when a B-50A superfortress named Lucky Lady 2 was refueled in air, enabling it to complete a nonstop flight. In 1992, an Air France Concorde, streaking at supersonic speed, set the all-time record for a suborbital flight at 32 hours and 49 minutes. At the time of writing, the Concorde is no longer in service despite efforts to bring it back. Occupants of the International Space Station orbit the Earth every 92 minutes. But what about the people like you and me? That is, those of us who don't own yachts built for this purpose or have access to Air Force fleets and state funding. In 2018, New Zealand's Andrew Fisher provided an answer when he set the world record for circling the globe on scheduled commercial flights, doing it in 52 hours and 34 minutes. With planning and a little bit of luck, you could do it too. Of all of these, Zachary and I reckoned our trip would be more like that of Phileas Fogg than any of the others. We weren't out to set any records, and I certainly had no intention of confronting hostile tribesmen. And while we wouldn't be using a hot air balloon, as had Fogg and Passepartout, we did plan to use just about every other form of transportation. Short and long haul flights, city trams and intercontinental trains, ships and boats, sports cars and four-wheel drives, tuk-tuks and rickshaws, and probably even bicycles and horses. After a series of lengthy flights, we were in Singapore. There is no better place to start our journey than here, a country hailed by many as the model for the rest of the world. Hyper-modern, hyper-clean, and hyper-rich, Singapore is the supermodel of countries. So much so, America by comparison looks like the frumpy, corpulent spinster who is past her prime but doesn't yet know it. Keeping with the metaphor, one Singaporean writer has compared this country to a date with a beautiful woman who just happens to have a bit of the psycho about her. If you steer your conversation and curiosity the right way, he says, your time with us will be unforgettable, but if you touch on a sore spot, we'll fly off the handle. Unforgettable is right. The distinct guttural grumble of Lamborghinis, Ferraris, Porsches, and others of that species are as common as F-150s in America. No wonder Formula One is racing there now, and almost everything looks shiny and new, even the people. The only other place on Earth I've seen like it is Shanghai. Flying back into Atlanta after a visit to that city felt like I was returning to a third world country. So it is with Singapore. Yes, Singapore is a remarkable place, and yes, it does overwhelm the senses, full as it is with eye candy. Night is a special time in this country that is smaller than Orange County. Searchlights paint the stainless steel buildings populating the skyline like pieces of art. Music fills the botanical gardens. People do the things fashionable, moneyed people do, whether eating in a trendy Michelin-starred restaurant, there are more in Singapore than in Paris, shopping at high-end boutiques, or attending outdoor concerts. The streets and sidewalks are so clean. I wondered if the Singaporean Department of Transportation employed an army of scrupulous maids wielding feather dusters rather than the hard-hatted guys you see in America. Trash, even gravel alongside roadsides, is so uncommon we started looking for it. You'll sooner find money on the ground than debris. But, as the writer said, there are sore spots with the woman that is Singapore, seductive though she may be. And it doesn't take much to reveal the Jack Nicholson in The Shining side of her. Her sore spots, the parts of her that remind you she's a psycho after all, include chewing gum. Unless it's a special gum prescribed by a doctor, it is illegal. And if you spit it out, oh, let's not even go there. Leaving a toilet unflushed. Unpleasant for sure, and I have admittedly felt the victim of a crime when my senses were assaulted by these stealthy hit-and-run offenders. But is a fine necessary when a bottle of Febreze will do? Walking around your house naked. I don't even want to know how they know you're doing this. Eating or drinking, even water, on public transportation. My heavens, we are on the equator here in Singapore. Not even a sip? Nope. At this point, perhaps you're wondering, as I did, has this country any boys in it? I mean, were these American laws, especially number two, so to speak, my entire college dorm and my three boys would have accumulated fines equal to that of their college tuition. How would you like to make monthly payments on that? There are, however, more interesting laws and corresponding punishments. Smoking an illicit, untaxed cigarette. I saw this warning on televisions. Yes, televisions in taxis. It only takes one cigarette to be marked a criminal. Penalty? Up to 6 years in prison. Using someone else's Wi-Fi without their permission. Called piggybacking, it is considered hacking and can land you in prison for up to 3 years. Graffiti or posting signage without a permit. Do you remember the American student Michael Fay? Thinking he was in East Los Angeles, he vandalized two cars and stole a road sign in Singapore. That was a mistake. He was arrested, imprisoned, and caned. Drug trafficking. Violate this one and you will get the death sentence. You will be hanged, as one Singaporean told me, and no one can save you, man. I'm cool with this one. Or am I? Draconian punishments are not typically created because the government in question is sadistic and longs for an opportunity to cane or hang its citizens. Sadistic governments just do that stuff anyway, regardless of the law. No, harsh legal penalties are generally meant to prevent the very thing for which punishments like caning and death are the consequence. In Malaysia and Indonesia, the two countries bracketing Singapore, drug trafficking is a major problem. To prevent it from infesting Singapore, the government sent a clear message to would-be traffickers with these laws. That makes sense, right? Don't want to be caned or hanged, people will say, then don't violate the law. That sounds simple enough, only it isn't so simple. Arguments like this are frustratingly stupid because they legitimize surrendering broad, sweeping powers to governments and the people who run them. And if history teaches anything, it is that people and governments are not to be trusted with broad, sweeping powers. Civil rights don't exist in Singapore. A few days ago, the country elected a president without voting. So much for democracy. Furthermore, Singapore has the second highest execution rate in the world. And why wouldn't it when drug trafficking brings a mandatory death sentence? Seeing warning, death to drug traffickers under Singapore law, stamped boldly on the immigration card the flight attendants handed out to passengers just before landing in this, the brave new world, I was momentarily gripped by a panic when the thought, "What about prescription drugs?" crossed my mind. A few years ago, I suffered a life-altering accident when I was hit by a car while cycling. Suffice it to say, I broke a lot of bones. 19 vertebrae, 12 ribs, multiple skull fractures, my neck, and so on. I spent quite some time in an intensive care unit and still suffer lingering effects. Before leaving the States, my physicians, I have a stable full of them now, prescribed several medications for pain. One was oxycodone. "You're fine, Dad. That's a prescription," Zachary said with perfect rationality. But I have had experience with irrational governments before. "I am not so sure," I replied, whipping out my smartphone like a gunslinger. A quick internet search revealed this medication to be outlawed without a permit, for which you must apply well before entering the country, and possession of more than 20 pills constituted trafficking. Suddenly, I felt caught in the world of Midnight Express, and worse, I was Billy Hayes. "Son, you ever been in a Turkish prison?" No, and I didn't want to be hanged in a Singaporean prison either. A couple of flushes down the toilet later, I was in the clear. Do you begin to see the problem? Please bear in mind, as anyone who knows me can tell you, I don't even drink, and by a strict definition of the law, are there any other definitions in a country like this? I was possibly a violator of one of their most severe laws. Like many, I was initially sympathetic with Singapore's stiff punishments for drug trafficking. Hang 'em, you say to yourself. But now I was getting a crash course in what it might mean to fall afoul of a government whose definition went well beyond types like Al Pacino's powder-nosed Scarface, and where innocent until proven guilty isn't a legal concept. And hanging alleged drug traffickers is one thing, but criminalizing chewing gum because you don't like getting it on your shoe? This is not only a surveillance state, and as Edward Snowden revealed, it is definitely a surveillance state. It is also a state where apparently those doing the surveilling have an obsessive-compulsive disorder. Sheesh. It's like the Truman Show, Zachary said, making a typically astute observation. He was spot on. Singapore is a kind of model society, very conscious of the fact that others look to it as a model, especially governments that want to combine free markets with dictatorship. That's why the country is so neat and tidy. Singapore is akin to a young family anxiously awaiting a visit from the in-laws. The lawn is freshly mowed, the house is cleaner than usual, and the kids have all been threatened within an inch of their lives to be on their best behavior. Had my wife and I employed Singaporean discipline in our home, who knows, maybe the kids would have made their beds and flushed the toilets. Whatever my opinion of the country, people in Singapore seem happy enough. That was also true of my experience in Shanghai. And why not, when it is so modern, so beautiful, and so wealthy? The problem lies in the shadows, the what-ifs of life under an undemocratic regime of this kind. Chiefly, what if you end up innocently on the wrong side of the law? There's no real due process because there's no freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom of assembly, or any other freedom the government doesn't, at that moment, want you to have. Interestingly, many of the left love Singapore. This is not entirely surprising given the left's historic fascination with totalitarian regimes. Walter Duranty, Moscow bureau chief for the New York Times, famously extolled the virtues of Stalin's Russia and was given a Pulitzer Prize for it. George Bernard Shaw, another classic liberal, did the same thing. They saw in that society precisely what they wanted to see. HuffPost, in an article titled "Why Singapore is the World's Most Successful Society," essentially declared the city-state the most successful society since human history began. Since human history began. Really? Does HuffPo really know what life was like for the Sumerians or the Egyptians of the Middle Kingdom? Hyperbole aside, Singapore scores high in rankings of this type because it scores high in categories like per capita income, education, and healthcare. It is as if freedom of anything just doesn't matter in this analysis. Calling it a benevolent dictatorship, the piece is a typical love fest. Call me a cynic, but I prefer leaders who are held accountable by the people. Modern Singapore is the result of the creative vision of Lee Kuan Yew. The longest-serving prime minister in history, he served from 1959 to 1990. Lee is alternately portrayed as a despot and a visionary. I think he was both. Lee led Singapore from third-world poverty to independence from Malaysia, 1965, and spectacular wealth. He also ruled as he wished. Let me be clear on this point. We liked Singapore. We really did. It is currently a marvelous place. We very much enjoyed the people we met. We were deeply impressed, as I have been generally in Asia, with the work ethic and service. Both are superior to anything I have experienced in America, and architecturally speaking, it is a very beautiful country. Singapore is a remarkable rags-to-riches story. Wow, were we going around the world in search of the planet's most improved country, Singapore would certainly win the prize. But that is not the standard we are employing here. We are going around the world in search of greatness, and, should we find it, to dissect the ingredients of that greatness so we might replicate it. I am looking for the country that would be a successor to what America has been. That country is not Singapore. No, regardless of its wealth, celebrated educational system, and glittering skyline, Singapore does not fall into that category. Singapore is an advanced surveillance state. Worse, according to foreign policy, the United States helped them build it, and now wants to model it. As with Western Europe, in the name of safety, cameras are watching people everywhere, and the data of private citizens is being gathered unfettered by the government for who knows what purposes. That apparently doesn't bother Singaporeans. It bothers me. However, this isn't my central reservation with Singapore. This is merely a symptom of a much larger problem. Singapore has beaten the odds by crawling out of the third world quagmire, and today its citizens enjoy a high standard of living, life expectancy, and just about everything else. All of this is true, but it is also beside the point as far as my critique is concerned. According to Jack Junda Lee, assistant professor of law at the School of Law of Singapore Management University, if you define a democracy as requiring broad freedom of speech and freedom of assembly, as I think most do, then it might be said that Singapore is somewhat lacking in this regard, as there are various restrictions on these rights. Somewhat lacking? If surveillance doesn't bother you, perhaps the recent election of a president in the absence of an actual election might. There are virtually no civil rights in Singapore. No free speech, on the grounds it causes civil unrest, no freedom of assembly, the government must grant a permit, and they don't, as a rule, grant such permits, no freedom of the press, all agencies are state-owned, no freedom of information, the internet is carefully and strictly controlled, no real opposition party, the People's Action Party maintains strict control of elections and has done so since 1959, and most of all.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.